Welcome back, everybody, for what is our third and final part of our comprehensive setup guide for Assetto Corsa Competizione. In the previous few parts, we covered the first four tabs on the setup menu, these being tyres, electronics, fuel and strategy, and mechanical grip. This third and final part sees us cover the last two setup pages, and these, of course, are dampers and aero settings. So let's jump into it. Damper is just another word for shock absorber, and this terminology makes it a little bit easier to visualise. The job of the damper is to control the energy that goes through the suspension when you're out on circuit. Changing damper settings affect how the energy is stored and how the energy is released, therefore affecting the behaviour of the car when the suspension springs are under load. We already covered the springs themselves in the previous part of this series during the mechanical grip section, so make sure you go and check that out if you haven't already. Those changes affected the amount of spring movement and the space available, whilst the shock absorbers control and affect the speed of these movements, and therefore how the energy created is collected and used. The damper screen may look a little bit intimidating at first, but when you look closely, there are really only two options, and each has two variants. Your bump setting controls how quickly the suspension springs get compressed when driving, therefore controlling how the energy is collected or stored. Your rebound setting controls how quickly the suspension springs decompress to their original state when driving, therefore controlling how the energy is used or spent. Both of these elements also have a fast setting, so we've got fast bump and fast rebound. To make things a bit clearer, think of the regular bump and rebound settings as slow bump and slow rebound. Slow damper settings affect how the damper behaves under normal circumstances with slow suspension movements, such as acceleration, braking, and cornering. Fast damper settings affect how the dampers behave in circumstances where the suspension movements are really fast, including hitting big bumps and riding curbs. So, to summarise, bump and rebound control the spring speed during slow suspension movements, whilst fast bump and fast rebound control the spring speed during fast suspension movements. All of these settings change in the same way. Increasing the number by clicking to the right has the effect of increasing the resistance of the spring, and therefore slowing down the compressions and decompressions. Decreasing these and clicking to the left make the springs less resistant, and therefore increases the speed of the compression and decompression. A slow compression with more resistance is stiffening the spring. A fast compression with less resistance is softening the spring. What all of this means is that in essence, damper adjustments controls the speed of the weight transfer in the car. It's also worth noting at this stage that your slow and fast rebound settings should always be at least as high, if not higher, than your slow and fast bump settings. The reason for this is that compressions always need to be as stiff or stiffer than the decompressions. I'm not a physics teacher, so can't really help you with the details on that one. In general, as you increase your bump and rebound settings, the suspension gets stiffer. So if you want your car to bounce around less and be more edgy under braking and during regular cornering, try increasing your regular bump and rebound settings. If you want your car to bounce around less over curbs and bumps, increase your fast bump and fast rebound settings. In contrast, if your car is too snappy or an edge through the corners and under braking, try lowering your regular bump and rebound. And if you want to be less on a knife edge over curbs and bumps, lower your fast bump and fast rebound. Hopefully that's enough information to give you at least a starting point when it comes to shock absorbers. If you want to take this even further, you can even use the damper histogram within the Motec i2 software to analyse the damper's behaviour over every bump. This allows you to fine-tune everything. See, there is a use for the telemetry lapse setting. This is it then, we have reached the final page of the setup menu. The aero settings are far more straightforward to visualise and understand than the damper and suspension settings, but they are hugely important, and usually quite a good starting point when you're first working on a setup. Let's get the least important setting out of the way first, and that's fuel load test. This is just a way of showing you how the ride height and therefore aero balance will be affected by fuel burning off over the course of a stint. So, for example, if you have 100 litres in the car, and you set temporary fuel load to 20 litres, the setup menu will show you what the actual ride height of the car will be once you've burned off your fuel and only have 20 litres remaining. Naturally, less weight will increase the ride height and more weight will decrease the ride height. Your fuel load test won't make a difference to your actual ride height settings, this is just a way to visualise how it will change during the course of a stint. So make sure, if you want to know exactly how high your ride height is going to be at the start of a stint, you have the setting disabled. The first of the main aero settings is ride height itself, and this is incredibly important. The ride height indicates how many millimetres there are between the ground and the underside of the car. You can change this height on both the front and the rear independently. Clicking to the right increases the height of the car, whilst clicking to the left decreases the height of the car. Generally speaking, racing cars suit lower ride heights on the front and back of the car rather than higher ride heights. Secondly, having a lower centre of gravity will make the car more stable through the corners and create less body movements from back to front and side to side. There are also two reasons why we don't just simply set the ride height to the minimum on both front and back. First of all, we don't want the underside of the car to bottom out and hit the circuit, especially not mid-corner, so we might need to create a little bit of space to avoid that. Secondly, and this is very important, it's not just about the overall height of the car, it's about the balance of height from front to back. If you've watched any Formula One in the past 5 years, you may have noticed pundits and engineers discussing the high rake design on a Red Bull, which is when the front of the car is much lower than the rear of the car. This isn't just so they can use their cars as launching ramps, it's so they can generate a specific and very deliberate aero balance from front to rear. Lowering the front ride height and raising the rear ride height will change the angle of the car, forcing more air to push the front of the car into the ground, giving you more grip at the front and less grip at the rear. This will give you a sharper turn in, but can cause oversteer, and also lose you some straight line performance, as the car will be less slippery when punching through the air. On the other hand, decreasing the rear ride height and raising the front will give you more grip at the back and less grip at the front. This will make your car understeer, giving you less turn-in ability but a more stable rear end. As per usual, it's a compromise. If you like having a car that's more oversteery, you might try the front ride height as low as you can without it bottoming out, and then find a sweet spot for the rear ride height. On the other hand, if you want maximum rear end grip, you might try and set the rear ride height to the lowest you can get away with, and then find a sweet spot for the front ride height. Next up, we have the rear wing. This is another way of influencing the aerodynamic balance of the car, but focusing on the rear. Increasing this number by clicking to the right will increase the steepness of the rear wing, giving you more rear downforce. Clicking left will reduce the number and the amount of additional downforce. Running less wing will make your car faster in a straight line, but give you less rear grip and therefore stability through the corners, whilst increasing the rear wing will give you more rear downforce and rear grip through the corners, in exchange for more drag and a slower straight line speed. So, what do you do if you're at a track where you need lots of straight line speed but you also need rear grip? Something like Paul Ricard, for example. Well, this is where you can use ride height to your advantage. Remember what I was saying before? Reduce your rear wing for more straight line speed, but change the balance of the car by increasing your front ride height and/or decreasing your rear ride height. In the opposite way, maybe there are only a few straights but lots of corners. You want a car that has lots of front end grip so turns in well, and you might need to go for a front focused aero setup with lower front ride height and higher rear ride height. But, of course, this can often lead to an unstable back end and therefore lots of spins, so you can then increase your rear wing to give you more of that rear end stability. As you've probably picked up by now, it's about all of these things working in harmony to create the perfect balance, with the best possible compromise. And that's where the magic tool at the bottom comes in, the front aero variation box. Before we fire into that though, let me just rattle through the remaining changeable options. On the front aero section, you will notice a setting labelled splitter. This is effectively doing the same job for the front of the car as the rear wing is doing for the back. A high number gives the front more grip, affecting the balance in the opposite way to the rear wing. However, many cars on ACC don't have a splitter you can adjust, and those that do will often only have a few settings to choose from, so even though it's more straightforward than the rear wing, it's also less effective. Then we have brake ducts. This is pretty much unrelated to the other stuff in the aero tab, but more to the stuff we covered in parts 1 and 2. Brake ducts channel air towards the brakes in order to keep them cool. The higher the number, the more air is allowed through, and therefore the cooler the brakes stay. This can not only affect the temperature of the brakes, but also the temperature of the tyre carcass, so bear in mind that any brake duct change may also affect the way your tyres behave and their pressures. Within the tyre widget when you're driving, there are four boxes representing the brake temperatures. Like the tyres, you want these to be green as often as possible, signalling they are in the optimum window, and different pad compounds have different friction tolerances, so may require different brake duct sizes to keep them in the optimum window. Simply put, if your brakes are getting yellow or orange too often, increase the brake duct size. If they're staying blue and not going green, decrease the brake duct size. It's also worth mentioning that you can have a different duct size for front and rear depending on your brake bias setting, something I covered in the previous video. Now then, the big finale, your front aero variation box. Many people will simply ignore this, but this is quite literally, well, not literally, this is quite metaphorically the linchpin that brings all of your aero adjustments together in perfect harmony. It all relates to what I was just banging on about, the aero balance from the front of the car to the back. This number is measured as a percentage, and a percentage above zero indicates that the car is more front aero heavy, whilst a negative number indicates that the car is more rear aero focused. Now, this is not about getting as close to zero as you can, it's about finding the balance that suits you the most. Just to reiterate what all of this means, a higher percentage equals a front heavy car, which means better turn-in but more oversteer and less rear end stability, whilst a negative percentage means more understeer, less turn-in ability but a more stable rear end. If you like having an oversteery car, for example, you will likely want to have a positive front end variation. If you prefer understeer and stability, you want to have negative front aero variation. Here are the ways in which you can achieve this. If you want to increase the front end aero, you can either reduce the front ride height and rear wing, or increase the rear ride height and splitter. If you want to decrease the front end aero and increase the rear end aero, you can either increase the front ride height and rear wing, or decrease the rear ride height and splitter. So you might be wondering, why does each individual value matter? Well, let's just say you're perfectly happy with the balance from understeer to oversteer, but you want your car to be faster on the straights. Take a note of the front aero variation. Let's say in this example it's around 4%. Now, how do we make a car faster on the straight? We decrease the rear wing. but now my variation is all wrong, it's way too high. I still wanted it at 4% for the balance. Well, you can then decrease the rear ride height to compensate. But now, what if my rear end is going to bottom out in the curbs? Well, increase the rear ride height back up again a little bit, but also increase the front ride height to keep the balance the same. And there we go, we have achieved the same aero balance through a different aero setup that is more suited to the nature of this particular circuit. Yay! Go numbers! So, that's us finally reached the end of this mini-series. To come full circle and reiterate a point I made at the beginning of part 1, it's all about getting everything working together in harmony. Always remember that each change can also affect another area of the car, so won't always have the desired or predicted effect. As long as you're aware of this, the more you learn, the more you will become familiar with how each change affects the overall behaviour of the car. I really hope we've been able to help you understand car setups on ACC in a basic yet detailed way, and now you can speak to some real engineers to further your understanding. If you did find these guides helpful, please let us know in the comments below and show your appreciation by giving us a like. Don't forget to subscribe to the Traction channel for more useful ACC content. We also have videos covering pretty much every corner of the racing game world, from Mario Kart and Wreckfest to hardware reviews and esports coverage. So, if you like racing games, you're in the right place. Until next time, keep it pinned, thank you so much for watching, and have a great aero balance. I mean day. Have a great day.